Good morning, all of you. I welcome all the principals of model schools, teachers, and students of the model schools. Today we are having three sessions. As part of these three sessions of webinar today, the first session we are having botany class. In this botany class, Mrs. L. Bharati, PGT Botany, TSMS Jarasangam, Sangareddy District, is going to continue our lecture on the plant physiology unit enzymes topic. Yesterday we discussed about the properties of the enzymes, activation energy, and certain other important aspects. Today once again she will revise a bit about them and later take you into the further aspects of the enzymes. Now I welcome Mrs. Bharati to proceed further.
Okay, thank you, sir. Good morning to all my coordinators, dignitaries, and principals, teachers, and my dear students. In yesterday's class, we have dealt with the topic enzymes under the unit 1 plant physiology. So just a quick review of what we have learned in yesterday's session, we'll do that. So the topics that were covered yesterday were chemical reaction, enzymatic conversions, and mechanism of enzyme action. So with the introduction part, we have discussed about the definition of the enzyme. So enzymes are nothing but the biocatalyst which bring about the high rate of biochemical reaction. So the reaction can be physicochemical or biochemical. Inside the body, whatever metabolic reactions are occurring, they are called as biochemical reactions. These biochemical reactions are very at faster rate because of the presence of enzymes. So these enzymes will enhance the rate of reaction. The term enzyme was first coined by Friedrich Wilhelm Kuhne in the year 1678. So in the year 1678, the enzymologist F.W. Kuhne has given the term enzyme. En means in and zyme means yeast. Because that time Louis Pasteur has been working with the alcoholic industry, that is microorganisms. And then later on they told in the bakery industries yeast is used. So first time fermentation was seen in the yeast microorganism only, with the help of yeast microorganism only. So they have taken the word from this yeast, that is zyme. So they have given the term enzyme. So almost all enzymes are protein. But all proteins are not enzymes. This we have dealt in yesterday's session. So there are few nucleic acid like RNA that behave like enzymes. These are called as ribozymes, especially 23S rRNA behave as a ribozyme. They bring about the formation of peptide bond during the protein synthesis. Comparison between the enzymes and the inorganic catalyst is dealt in the next slide, that is, enzymes are protein, but inorganic catalysts are not protein, they are metal ions. Enzymes get denatured and inactive at high temperature and pressures, but inorganic catalysts do not undergo any change, they remain active in high temperature and pressure also. These enzymes, the biocatalyst, will have active sites for the substrate to bind, and these inorganic catalysts do not have any active sites for the molecules to come and bind and produce a product. These enzymes are very specific in their action, like urease enzyme will be acting upon urea. Pepsin enzyme will be acting upon proteins. Amylase enzyme will be acting upon carbohydrates. Like that, the activity of the enzyme is very specific. But inorganic catalysts are not so specific. They can react with any molecule pertaining to that given specified catalyst only. So example for this is nickel catalyst and molybdenum catalyst. Like that, various inorganic catalysts are present which will carry out various physicochemical reactions. Next, we have dealt with the active site. Active sites are nothing but the cleft or a pocket in the 3D structure of the enzyme. In the tertiary structure of the enzymes, active sites are present. In this active site only, the substrate will come and bind to the enzyme. That is why it is called as active site. This active site is made up of generally 3 to 12 amino acids. Next, substrate is nothing but the substance which is converted into the product. In chemistry, we deal with the reactants. Reactants are converted into the product in presence or absence of catalyst. Like that, in the biomolecule, substrate, it is called as substrate. The reactant is called as substrate, and this substrate is converted to the product in the presence of enzyme. The product is nothing but the molecule formed after the completion of the reaction. That is, the substrate is converted into the product. For example, if you take glucose to glucose-6-phosphate, it takes place in the presence of enzyme hexokinase. So here glucose is the substrate and glucose-6-phosphate is the product. And the enzyme used here is hexokinase. This is hastened, this reaction is hastened because of the presence of hexokinase enzyme. Chemical reactions, they are nothing but, what is a reaction actually? Reaction is nothing but a conversion. The reactants are converted into products or the substrate are converted into the products. So reaction can be just chemical conversion or a metabolic conversion. We have seen both chemical change and physical change in a compound. The physical change is nothing but the change in the shape or the structure of the substrate or the molecule. Chemical change will be showing the making or breaking of the bonds. So in the water, if you take both the physical change and chemical change is seen. For example, if you take the solid form of water, that is ice, this is converted into water, that is a liquid form. And then water, when heated, becomes the water vapor, that is a gaseous form. So we see both physical change, the shape is changing in this water molecule, and also that there are the making and breaking of the bonds in the water molecule. So both physical and chemical changes are seen in the water molecule. Like that, in various compounds also, physical and chemical change together can be seen. There are two kinds of reaction, inorganic chemical reaction and organic chemical reaction. Inorganic chemical reaction takes place in the chemical compounds. For example, here we have taken the example of barium hydroxide and sulfuric acid. When the barium hydroxide reacts with the sulfuric acid solution, the bond between the barium and the hydroxyl ions will break up and barium will combine with the sulfate and the water molecule is formed. This is taking place in the chemical compound, that is why it is called as inorganic chemical reaction. If you take the organic chemical reaction, in this biomolecules are involved. Starch is converted into glucose. So starch is the substrate and glucose is the product. In this biomolecule, starch is present and the biomolecule glucose is produced. So starch is converted into glucose. So organic compounds or the biomolecules are involved. That is why it is called as organic chemical reaction. The rate or the velocity of the reaction. The velocity of the reaction. Velocity is nothing but generally speed in a direction. So when the products are formed per unit time, it is called the rate or velocity of the reaction. So when and where the substrate is converted into product, the rate can increase or it can be decreased also. So in the enzymes, if the enzymes are present in the premises, these reactions are carried out at very high rate. So these enzymes show the turnover number. What is a turnover number? Turnover number is nothing but number of molecules into which the substrate are converted into products in unit time, that is per second. But it is only pertaining to one active site. If the enzyme has more active site, separately the turnover number will be seen. Generally, the turnover number is calculated for one active site of the enzyme. So in this, the maximum number of chemical conversions of the substrate molecule per second that has given a single catalytic site will execute for the enzyme concentration with two or more active sites. The enzyme, that is carbonic anhydrase, helps in the conversion of carbon dioxide and water molecule into the carbonic acid. This carbonic anhydrase is known as fastest acting enzyme because it has the highest turnover number, that is around 6 lakhs per second. So generally, when this enzyme is absent, only 200 molecules is formed in an hour. But when the enzyme is present, 6 lakhs molecule is formed in a second. That means it is increased by 10 million times. So that is why another enzyme is also there, catalase. But previously they thought that catalase is having highest turnover number, but later on they along with the catalytic efficiency they found out that carbonic anhydrase is the fastest acting enzyme. So carbonic anhydrase turnover number is 6 lakhs per second. Glycolysis pathway, you will study this in the respiration chapter. It has 10 steps to form pyruvic acid from the glucose, and each step is carried out by a specific enzyme. So this conversion of glucose to pyruvic acid includes 10 different enzymes. So each step is carried out by a specific enzyme. For example, this reaction, glucose is taking place in oxygen. It is called as aerobic reaction. In the aerobic reaction, pyruvic acid is formed. But suppose this oxygen is absent, that means the glucose is converted into lactic acid in the skeletal muscles, or in absence of oxygen, it is also converted into ethanol in the yeast, that is during the fermentation process. So depending upon the conditions also, various products are formed in presence of enzymes. Now we'll come to the topic enzymatic conversions. Enzymatic conversions are nothing but formation of the products from the substrate in presence of enzyme. I told you already enzymes will be having the active sites. So because of the presence of this active site only, the substrate are converted into the product. So enzymes help in conversion of substrate into the product. Here they have given the example of the glucose. It is converted into the glucose 6-phosphate in presence of the enzyme hexokinase. So substrate here is glucose and product here is glucose 6-phosphate. The substrate binds to the active site of the enzyme to form ES complex. So when the substrate is binding to the active site of the enzyme, it forms a temporary formation that is called as enzyme substrate complex. This enzyme substrate complex is called as transition state or the intermediate state, which is very highly unstable. Immediately, either it will form again enzyme in the substrate, or it can form again enzyme in the product. So this ES complex is very important for the conversion of the substrate into the product. Now after the making and breaking of the bond, the product P is released along with the unchanged free enzyme. So when the enzyme substrate complex is formed, enzyme and product is formed from the enzyme substrate complex. During this, intermediate stage is also seen, that is enzyme and product. This theory has been given by Michaelis. It is called as enzyme substrate complex theory. So this theory shows the importance of enzyme substrate complex. So what is this theory? Enzyme
Good morning, all of you. There is once again a small technical problem, so I will continue from where Mrs. Bharati is abruptly ended our session because of some technical problems. So let us move on. So enzymatic conversions means enzymes brings about high rate of conversion because of their active sites. We are discussing about the enzymes convert substrate into product. For example, here we are having glucose molecule. In the presence of one enzyme, this glucose molecule will be converted into glucose 6-phosphate. While converting, it has to pass through the transition state. The transition state yesterday we discussed. So here the Michaelis proposed a theory. Enzyme initially combines with the substrate to form the enzyme substrate complex. That enzyme substrate complex is a reversible reaction. This enzyme substrate complex later forms the enzyme product complex. This enzyme product complex will later produce as the enzyme and product. By that, the reaction will end. So that explains the formation of product from the substrate by using the enzyme. So yesterday also we have seen this diagram. This is the enzyme. This enzyme is having an active site. At that active site, the substrate sucrose molecule, the substrate is binding to the active site of the enzyme, and it is forming the enzyme substrate complex. This enzyme substrate complex later it is producing the enzyme and glucose fructose molecules. Glucose and fructose are the products, whereas the substrate sucrose is the substrate. This also we discussed yesterday. So concept of activation energy, yesterday while discussing about the conversion of substrate into products, we discussed about the activation energy. All the molecules, when they are existing as the substrates, they are present in the form of they are having certain amount of potential energy. Now the substrate is having potential energy, the product is also having potential energy, but for the conversion of substrate into product, it has to pass through certain difference of energy. The difference of energy is called as activation energy. So here we are showing one diagram. So this is the enzyme and we are having a substrate. For example, this substrate has to be converted into this blue color is the substrate, red color is the product. If this blue colored substrate has to be converted into product, it has to pass through this dotted line. That dotted line is called activation energy. In the absence of the enzyme, that activation energy is very high. Whereas in the presence of the enzyme, the activation energy gets reduced. Here you can see the activation energy is reduced in the presence of the enzyme. So the molecule can be easily converted into product. So that is how the enzymes facilitates the reaction and enhances the rate of reaction. We have seen this diagram yesterday also. So this is the enzyme molecule. The enzyme molecule binds the substrate molecule at its active site. The substrate molecule and enzymes forms enzyme substrate complex. Later they produce the products. Enzyme remain as such. Enzyme does not undergo any change. That is the basic principle of all enzymatic reactions. Enzymes only catalyzes the reactions without participating in the reaction. They just acts as a middleman. So yesterday we have seen this diagram also. Here you can see the on the x-axis we have shown the progress of reaction, on the y-axis we have shown the potential energy. Each substrate, if it has to be converted into product, it should pass through the activation energy. The red line is the activation energy in the absence of the enzyme. The blue line is the activation energy in the presence of the enzyme. So when the enzyme is present, the activation energy is less. When the activation energy is less, the substrate can be easily converted into product. So when we are giving the carbonic anhydrase enzyme example, it was told that in the presence of the enzyme, 6 lakh molecules can be converted from substrate to product state within 1 second. Whereas in the absence of the enzyme, only 200 molecules can be converted from substrate state to product. That is the efficiency of the enzymes. Enzymes enhances the rate of reaction millions of times. So that is why various biochemical reactions in our body requires the presence of the enzyme. in the absence of enzymes, many of these metabolic activities does not takes place. Endothermic reaction. Yesterday we have discussed about the differences between the exothermic and endothermic reaction. The reactions that liberates energy are called exothermic reaction. For example, respiration. The reactions that requires energy are called endothermic reaction. For example, photosynthesis. In both the exothermic reactions and endothermic reaction, there will be activation energy. That activation energy is reduced substantially by the enzymes, so the reactions takes place at a faster rate. So this is all the we learned yesterday. Today we are going to learn about few more topics, that is nature of enzyme action and the factors affecting the enzyme activity. So once again we are showing the same diagram. This is the enzyme and we are having a substrate. This enzyme and the substrate sucrose molecule binding to the active site of the enzyme. By binding to the active site of the enzyme, it is forming the enzyme substrate complex. Later this enzyme substrate complex is getting separated into enzyme and product. So this is the normal principle, but there are two theories how this enzyme substrate has been forming. There are two theories to explain this. One is called lock and key hypothesis. One is lock and key hypothesis proposed by Emil Fischer. The second one is the theory proposed by Daniel Koshland. The lock and key hypothesis was, madam.
Sir, I'll take up, sir.
Okay, take up.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
So take up from here only.
Okay, sir. So
okay. Continue.
Okay, sir.
I will disable the screen share. Okay, now you can start.
Okay, sir.
There were some power problem issues. Kindly excuse both of us.
I'm continuing, sir. So
relax and continue, no problem.
Okay, sir. Okay, so nature of enzyme action shows the importance of enzyme substrate complex. Enzyme substrate complex is nothing but an activated complex, or it is also called as Michaelis complex. This enzyme has been in this picture, they have shown two active sites, and the substrate is a sucrose. So this sucrose substrate will go and bind to the enzyme sucrase at the active site, and an enzyme substrate complex is formed. So because of the formation of this enzyme substrate complex only, the products are formed. That is why this enzyme substrate complex is very important. So after that, the products are formed into glucose and fructose with the free enzyme. So this is called as enzyme substrate complex theory. This theory has been explained by Emil Fischer and Daniel E. Koshland. So Emil Fischer has given the lock and key hypothesis in the year 1884, and Daniel E. Koshland has given this hypothesis, induced fit hypothesis, in the year 1973. So Emil Fischer has told that like a lock and a key, they fit into each other. Enzyme and substrate also fit into each other. So lock is representing the enzyme and the key is represented by the substrate. So this key comes and binds with the lock, like that substrate comes and binds with the enzyme at the active site. Induced fit hypothesis was given by Daniel E. Koshland. This person has told that the enzyme will be changing its shape little bit so that the substrate will come and bind to it. Then later on, after products are formed, the enzymes will regain its original shape. This is called as induced fit hypothesis. The person Emil Fischer is known as father of biochemistry, and this person is Daniel E. Koshland. They have given the enzyme substrate complex theory. Now we'll come to the catalytic cycle of the enzyme action. That means how does an enzyme act upon the substrate? So first of all, the substrate will come and bind to the active site of the enzyme. So in the active site, I told you the amino acids are present. In this amino acids, the R groups, the alkyl groups will be reacting with the substrate so that the bonds are formed between them and new bonds are formed in the formation of the products. So as soon as the substrate comes and bind with the active site, it will alter the shape of the enzyme so that the substrate will easily and tightly bind around the enzyme. So after the binding, it will alter the shape. That is the second step. Next, third step is that after the substrate binds, the enzyme will break the chemical bonds that is already present in the substrate, and then new bonds are formed. Otherwise, the new bonds will be formed between the substrate molecules, or the bonds between the substrate molecules can also break. So depending upon the breaking or making of the bonds, the products are formed. So when the bonds are broken, products are formed and free enzyme is released. So fourth step is that enzyme is free after the formation of product. This enzyme, free enzyme, unchanged enzyme will again react with the substrate and the cycle goes on. This is called as catalytic cycle, that is activity of the enzyme. Here you can see the pictorial graph. In this catalyst is given in this form with two active sites. First one, substrate A, will come and bind at the active site so that it will tightly fit into the active site. And then later on, substrate B will come and bind beside it at the active site pertaining to its shape. Now the bond between B and A is formed, peptide bond between B and A is formed, and then the product is formed, and this product is released with the free enzyme again. Now this again, the enzyme will react with the substrate so that the cycle will go on. This is called as catalytic cycle of the enzyme action. The factors affecting enzyme activity. So enzyme action is also affected by external factors. These external factors are changing the tertiary structure of the enzyme. Tertiary structure means the enzyme activity is not seen in a linear form or in a plane or in a dot. Only if the enzyme acquires a tertiary structure, that is active sites are formed. Active sites are nothing but the cleft or the pockets in the tertiary structure of the enzyme. There the substrate will come and bind. So these activity is affected by temperature, pH, and change in the substrate concentration and the inhibitors, that is the specific chemicals. So first we'll deal with the temperature. So temperature, you all know, it has three cardinal points, that is minimum, maximum, and optimum. So at minimum temperature, the enzyme activity will be less. If the temperature is increased, that is at the maximum temperature, the enzymes will get denatured because enzymes are proteins, I said. So proteins will get denatured at the high temperature. Likewise, enzymes also get denatured at the high temperature. So the optimum temperature, maximum activity of the enzyme is seen. So optimum temperature is nothing but 40 degrees centigrade. Suppose previously Louis Pasteur has done the pasteurization. In the pasteurization, he has told about the boiling of the milk will kill the microorganisms, because the enzymes present in the microorganisms will get denatured because of the heat. That is why they don't show any activity and the milk is not spoiled. Likewise, even if the temperature is lowered, then also the microorganisms, microbial enzymes will not show any activity. They will become inactive. That's why we keep the food products in the fridge so that the temperature is lower. So this, the temperature also affects the enzyme activity. Next is the pH. P stands for the power, H stands for the hydrogen. So pH is nothing but the negative logarithm of the hydrogen ion concentration. So every enzyme will be having an optimum pH. This also shows the cardinal points, that is minimum, maximum, and the optimum. So optimum pH is 6.0 to 7.5. And if the hydrogen ion concentration is increasing, that means acidity is increasing in the medium, or if the hydrogen ion concentration is decreasing, that is OH hydroxyl ions are increasing, it is an alkaline medium, the enzyme will not be active. So at acidic medium or alkaline medium, the enzymes generally will not be active. Only at optimum pH only the enzymes will be active and the reaction is carried out. So optimum pH is 6 to 7.5. That means near the neutral pH. So if you take the pepsin, pepsin will act at 2.2 pH and trypsin will act at 8.8 pH. That means pepsin will act only in the acidic medium and the trypsin will act in the alkaline medium. That is their optimum pH. So it can change according to the enzyme. So in the graph, if you see, the pH has started increasing and the enzyme activity has also increased. And at the certain point, the enzyme activity is maximum. So this point is the optimum pH for that enzyme activity. So as the pH is again increasing, the enzyme activity will decrease. So after that, it will stop completely because the enzyme will get denatured or inactive. So temperature and pH both are affecting the enzyme activity. Next is the concentration of the substrate. So concentration of the substrate will tell about the activity or the velocity of the enzyme. So when the substrate concentration is increased, the enzyme velocity will also increase. The rate of enzyme activity will increase, or the velocity of the enzyme activity will increase. So as we are going on increasing the substrate concentration, it will reach till a maximal velocity. At this maximum velocity, enzyme substrate complex is formed. This maximum velocity is denoted by Vmax. So at this enzyme substrate complex, the velocity of the enzyme activity will be maximum. That is why it is called as maximum velocity. And that point is called as, is reached by the enzyme substrate complex. So beyond this, even if you add the substrate concentration, substrate molecules more, the velocity will not increase. It will be stable like that. So the enzyme activity will not increase. So it will become stable because the enzymes are completely saturated with the substrate molecules. There is no other enzyme present in the medium so that the substrate will come and bind to it. So substrate concentration will be increased at up to certain level. It will show maximum velocity till that level, till the formation of enzyme substrate complex. Then after that, even if you add the substrate molecules, there won't be any increase in the rate of enzyme activity. This substrate concentration which you are adding and half the maximum reaction rate is called as Michaelis-Menten constant. That is, it is denoted by Km. Michaelis-Menten constant is nothing but substrate concentration caused for the half the maximum Vmax. Half of the Vmax will take. So how much half of the Vmax is needed? That will show the Km value on the substrate axis. And this Km value is represented by the approximate inverse measures of the affinity of the enzyme for a given substrate. For example, if you see this graph, in the y-axis, initial velocity is shown, that is the rate of enzyme activity is shown. In the x-axis, substrate concentration is shown. So as the substrate concentration is increasing, the rate of the reaction, enzyme activity is also increasing. So at a certain point, the maximum velocity is reached by the enzyme. The reaction is reached till the maximum at certain point. And that point denotes the enzyme substrate complex. So after that maximum velocity is reached, the activity of the enzyme to form more enzyme substrate complex is not seen because the enzymes are completely saturated with the substrate molecule. So half of this, if you see half of this, that gives Km value on the substrate concentration. So substrate concentration required for giving the half of the maximum velocity is called as Michaelis-Menten constant. It is denoted by Km. This Km will show the affinity of the enzymes to the substrate. That means if Km value is more, the affinity of the enzyme to the substrate will be less. And if the Km value is less, the affinity of the enzyme to the substrate is more. So generally Km value should be less only, so that the enzymes will be reacting, the active sites of the enzymes will be binding with the substrate molecule. So generally Km value or the Michaelis-Menten constant will be less only. So this is about the Michaelis-Menten constant. Is an important topic, children. So this, you can expect this question in the exam. Now next is the binding of the specific chemicals. Chemicals are nothing but the inhibitors. So inhibitors, inhibition means stopping something, some activity, or stopping from something. That is called as inhibition. So inhibition are shown by these chemicals involved in the enzyme activity. So enzyme activity is also affected by the chemicals that is present in the medium. So these chemicals which shut off the enzyme activity are called as inhibitors. So chemicals are called as inhibitors because they completely close the enzyme activity. And this process is called as inhibition. And inhibitors will show the inhibition process when they are present in the medium. There are three types of inhibition: competitive inhibition, non-competitive inhibition, and the feedback inhibition. So we'll come to the slide competitive inhibition. Competitive inhibition, in the name itself, it is suggested competitive. That means there will be some competition between the enzyme and the inhibitor, a substrate and the inhibitor. So in the competitive inhibition, the inhibitor will closely resemble the substrate molecule in structure. The structure of the substrate will be same like the inhibitor. So because of that, the inhibitor will come and bind to the active site of the enzyme. The inhibitor will come and bind to the active site of the enzyme so that the catalysis process is stopped. So this inhibitor will not allow the enzyme to form the products. That is why it is called as competitive inhibition. So competitive inhibition means the inhibitor will come and bind to the active site of the enzyme because it is resembling in structure with the substrate molecule. For example, we'll take an example. It will be easier for you to understand, children. So inhibitor we have here is malonate, and the substrate is succinate, and the enzyme is succinic dehydrogenase. So generally the substrate succinate will be converted into fumaric acid in presence of the succinic dehydrogenase by removal of hydrogen atom. So succinate will give rise to fumaric acid by removal of hydrogen atom in presence of succinic dehydrogenase. So this malonate inhibitor, the malonate, will be resembling in structure like the succinate substrate. So succinate substrate and the malonate both are in similar structure. That is why the malonate will come and bind with the active site of this enzyme succinic dehydrogenase, and fumaric acid is not formed. That means the synthesis of fumaric acid is stopped. The catalysis will not occur. That is, the inhibitor is stopping the process of catalysis in the medium. That means the inhibitor is shutting down the activity of the enzyme. So it is competing with the succinate, that is the substrate, for the enzyme. That is why this is called as competitive inhibition. So even the drugs that are used for the killing of the bacterial pathogen in our body are nothing but they are showing competitive inhibition only. Okay, the sulfa drugs, generally they are given as antibiotic because they go and bind with the bacterial enzymes, and then the activity of the bacterial enzyme is stopped so that there is no reproduction of the bacteria or the increase in number of bacteria, so that the infection will stop. So drugs also acts as competitive inhibitor. The next slide is competitive inhibition, that is generally the reaction. How does the reaction takes place? They are given in the first part, and in the second part, how does the inhibition take place? So the substrate molecule will come and bind to the enzyme at the active site. by this, by now you might have learned about this also. You might have understand what happens actually in the catalytic cycle of the enzyme action. So substrate will come and bind to the enzyme at the active site. Enzyme substrate complex is formed, and after this, the products are released with the free enzyme. This is general catalytic cycle that is seen in the enzyme activity. So in the inhibition process, what happens in the medium, the inhibitor is present. This is the inhibitor. It is having the similar shape with the active site. You can notice the aroma pointer here. It is having the similar shape with the active site and the substrate molecule. Okay. So the inhibitor will now compete with the substrate for the active site on the enzyme, and it will go and bind with the enzyme, forming an enzyme inhibitor complex. So enzyme inhibitor complex will not allow the binding of substrate to this complex, and enzyme inhibitor complex, they don't bind. That means the activity is stopped. There are no products formed. Okay. So it is competitive inhibition. Okay. So competitive inhibition means the inhibitor will compete with the substrate for the active site in the enzyme. That is why it is called as competitive inhibition. Okay. Non-competitive inhibition means the inhibitors will not have any similar structure with the substrate as we have seen earlier, but they go and bind to the some other site present on the enzyme, and they will change the shape of the enzyme so that the substrate molecule will not come and bind with the enzyme. Okay. So here you have to notice that the inhibitor will come and bind to the enzyme other than the active site, so that the structure of the enzyme shape will slightly change, so that the substrate molecule will not come and bind at the active site. And this is called as non-competitive inhibition. There is no competition between the substrate and the inhibitor, but the shape of the enzyme will change. That is why the catalysis will not occur. So even if you increase the substrate concentration, the inhibition will not stop. And as a result, the catalysis does not take place because of the formation of enzyme inhibitor complex or enzyme substrate inhibitor complex. So metal ions, generally copper, silver, mercury, potassium, magnesium, they act as non-competitive inhibitor. They stop the process of enzyme activity during the synthesis of the products. This is the non-competitive inhibition graph. So in this is the enzyme. Enzyme is having a rectangular shape, active site, and substrate is present beside it. And at another side, you can see a depression or a cleft or a pocket here. And this is attacked by the inhibitor. This inhibitor will come and join at the site of the enzyme, thereby changing the shape of the active site. You can see there is a change in the active site shape. So because of this, the substrate will not tightly bind to the active site and no products are formed. So as long as this inhibitor is binding with the enzyme, the products are not formed. So it is inhibiting the activity of the enzyme. That is why it is called as non-competitive inhibition. Next is feedback inhibition. The end product of the enzyme catalyzed reaction will be accumulating in the medium, then they act as inhibition. For example, if you see this reaction, the glucose is converted to glucose 6-phosphate by phosphorylation. That is, energy is supplied. The glucose is formed into glucose 6-phosphate in presence of enzyme hexokinase. So as and when this glucose 6-phosphate is accumulating in the medium, the reaction will little bit continue. But as the percentage is increasing, it will not allow the hexokinase to produce more glucose 6-phosphate. That means it will stop the activity of the hexokinase because of this end product. So this end product will not allow the hexokinase to produce more of glucose 6-phosphate in the medium. As and when this glucose 6-phosphate is utilized, then again the activity of the hexokinase will be seen. So this is called as feedback mechanism or feedback inhibition, because it is stopping the activity of the enzyme. It is called as feedback inhibition, and it shows control, the homeostatic control of the metabolism. That is why all the compounds are present in proper concentration in our body, and we don't have any adverse effect of this metabolic pathways. So feedback inhibition, it is an important topic. They may ask in the exam also, children. So understand this, the end product will inhibit the reaction by binding to the enzyme. The as the product is getting accumulated, it will stop the activity of the enzyme. That is called as feedback inhibition. Okay, children. Now, the feedback inhibition, they have given the pictorial graph. You can see there are two enzymes here, and two products are present. You can see here. This is the substrate molecule, and this is the enzyme. So, substrate molecules is coming and binding to the enzyme at the active site. Okay. Now, next substrate molecule is binding to the other enzyme. So, there is formation of ES complex, and end product is formed. Okay. So, this end product will go and bind to the enzyme. Okay. So, the substrate molecules which is present in the medium will also try to bind, but it will not bind with the, because of the change in the active site. This will not react. But this end product has stopped the activity of this enzyme. That means it is inhibiting the enzyme to form more products. Okay. So this is called as feedback inhibition. So the end product, glucose-6-phosphate, will bind to the hexokinase if it gets more accumulated in the media. So when this hexokinase is stopped from producing glucose-6-phosphate, till glucose-6-phosphate is utilized, till then the more production of glucose-6-phosphate is not seen. So the end product is inhibiting the reaction. This is called as feedback inhibition. Okay, children, I think you understood now. This is very important in the examination point of view. So now it is time to answer the questions. What is meant by feedback inhibition? Just now I told you what is meant by feedback inhibition. So feedback inhibition means the end product of the enzyme catalyzed reaction is stopped because of the binding of the end product to the enzyme. That means the end product will not allow the enzyme to show its activity. Okay, that is called as feedback inhibition. And you can give the example of the glucose forming glucose-6-phosphate. Okay, next question is, who proposed lock and key hypothesis and induced fit hypothesis? Lock and key hypothesis was proposed by Emil Fischer in the year 1884. And induced fit hypothesis was proposed by Daniel E. Koshland in the year 1973. Okay, next question is, explain the importance of enzyme substrate complex formation. So enzyme substrate complex formation is very important for the formation of the enzyme and the products. After the formation of this enzyme substrate complex, only products are formed and free enzyme is formed so that the catalytic reaction will continue. Okay. So the hypothesis has been given by Emil Fischer and Daniel E. Koshland. Emil Fischer has given the lock and key hypothesis, and Daniel E. Koshland has given the induced fit hypothesis. Next question is, write briefly about the enzyme inhibitor. So enzyme inhibitors, or generally it is enzyme inhibition that is being taught. So enzyme inhibition, three types are there: competitive inhibition, non-competitive inhibition, and feedback inhibition. So in while explaining about these topics, you can give examples also. You can draw the diagrams which has been displayed in the slides. So next is, what is Michaelis constant? Michaelis constant is represented by Km. It is nothing but the substrate concentration caused to make the velocity of the reaction, maximum velocity of the reaction, to its half of it. That is called as Michaelis constant. You can draw the graph and explain it. So Michaelis constant shows the inverse measures of the affinity of the enzyme to the substrate. If the Km value is less, it is good because it shows more affinity of the enzyme to the substrate. That's what we want in the reaction. Okay, children. So with this, the session is completed. Thank you, sir.
Bharati madam.
Sir.
Kontamandi pillalu, they are asking about this activation energy. They want to have 2 or 3 minutes revision on that particular topic.
Okay,
please go back to that activation energy.
Okay, sir.
And please explain again so that they will understand better.
Okay, sir.
Back.
Okay, sir.
Oh, here.
Okay, children. Concept of activation energy. Now, what is activation energy? Suppose we are doing some work. We need some energy. Okay. So that energy, if it is less, we'll do less work. If it is more, we'll go for more work. So that is called as activation energy in our cells. Like that, enzymes and substrate will also have some activation energy. Substrate molecules will have some activation energy. So when this activation energy is represented in the graph, that is potential energy, generally we call it as. So this potential energy will be converted into kinetic energy. That is, movement is seen in the substrate molecule, and this substrate molecule will go and bind to the enzyme so that the transition state is seen. If you see this diagram, this level is the potential energy of the substrate. Okay. So as the substrate is binding with the enzyme, the level of the activation barrier, that is the transition state, is lowered. That is because of the presence of enzyme. If this enzyme is not present, the transition state will be higher than that. So to reach that, the activation energy should be more in the substrate molecule. Okay. So as I'll tell once again. So ES complex is formed by the binding of substrate to the enzyme. So this ES complex is highly unstable. Okay. So it can be depicted in the graph. That is, y-axis represents potential energy and x-axis represents progress of the reaction. Okay. So at this stage, if you see, this is the energy possessed by the molecule, and this is the substrate concentration. So activation energy possessed by the substrate molecule reacting with the to form the product is high. Okay, this peak is called as transition state. Okay, at this peak, the substrate will be converted into the product. Okay, now when the enzyme is added to this substrate, when the substrate comes and binds with the enzyme at the active site, this peak is lowered. The activation barrier is lowered. The transition state is lowered. Here in this stage, enzyme substrate complex is formed. So when the enzyme substrate complex is formed, the enzyme will lower the activation energy. Okay. So more molecules are formed here. That is, enzyme substrate complex is formed here. But without the presence of enzyme, this transition state level, the energy possessed in the transition state will be higher. And then later on, the formation of products will be less if the enzyme is not present in the medium. But if the enzyme is present in the medium, the formation of the products will be more. For example, suppose we take the substrate molecules. One is having 2 energy level, another one is having 3 energy level, another one is having 4 energy level, and another one is having 5 energy level. Okay. So the activation energy level to form the transition state, you take it as 4. Okay. So the substrate molecule which is having 4, that is 5, will be passing through the transition state and form the product. Okay. But remaining, which is having the energy level 2 and 3, will not form the
seems once again there is some technical problem. So she is explaining about this energy transition state. All the molecules that are having low energy cannot be converted into product unless they are having sufficient energy. The enzyme molecules actually reduces that transition state activation energy and easily converts the substrates into products. So enzymes are responsible for bringing down the activation energy. By bringing down the activation energy, they enhances the rate of reaction. So today we discussed about various important topics. We defined enzymes. We discussed about the functioning of the enzymes. We discussed about the discovery of the enzymes and their functioning. Two hypotheses. One is the lock and key hypothesis, and another one is the induced fit hypothesis that we discussed. Later we moved on to the different factors that are affecting the enzymatic action. Temperature affects the enzymatic action. pH affects the enzymatic action. Substrate concentration. Substrate concentration and other inhibitors also are responsible for the enzymatic affecting the enzymatic activity. We thank Bharati for presenting a good lecture on this particular topic. Tomorrow we will discuss about the enzyme classification. Thank you one and all for joining the session. The next session follows in 2 or 3 minutes. Thank you. Shalya madam.